we were deep in a very hard training block where you're doing like, I don't know, a lot of hours of cardio on a weekly basis. And one of the workouts, I'm sure you've probably done a fartlek, Danica, where you're doing five. Have you done those before? Yeah. Five, four, a fartlek. Yeah, it's kind of an interesting name.
I don't fart. I'm a girl.
It's Swedish for speed play. So it's like a 5 minute effort at like X pace, 2 minutes easy, 4 minute effort at Y pace, 2 minutes, a little bit harder, harder, harder. The effort gets shorter, but harder.
I mean, I've done structures like that, but I haven't.
Yeah. So you haven't called it a fartlek though?
No, I just called it interval training.
So we had a big fartlek coming up, and Matt was like, hey, I'll join you on this workout. And I remember being like, dude, I don't know, with love and respect, I don't know if this is one you want to just like hop in on if you're a big runner.
Was he as buff as he is now?
Totally. Oh yeah. Oh. I mean, maybe not quite as big as he is now.
I hadn't gotten into CrossFit yet. So I wasn't,
he wasn't in marathon. He didn't look like a marathon runner. We'll call him that. So he joined me. He hung on for like 90% of it, we'll say. I remember I got back and Brooke and I were like, damn, that was like, what a savage. That was like, you have to be a freak to be able to deal with that. And
I couldn't do anything for about a month after that.
An impromptu fartlek to move by your knees.
But I think that like cemented, like, I think Matt and I, like, you know, a startup is really hard. You know, you just spend your whole day, your every week and moment of your day getting kicked in the teeth. And I think like that kind of, for me, was like a good indication of like, all right, this person has like that, either has one or is missing that extra chromosome to be able to do like this craziness, you know?
Yeah. There's always been something, just like the bond, I guess, through working out with someone or training, like, even in hockey, like some of my best relationships have come through the guys, you know, I do extra workouts with, or we'd go do some extra stuff with them, with Kevin. I think that's kind of your point, like why we, you know, we connected back, and like, what was it that all of a sudden, you know, we have other close friends, why didn't we start a company with them? We love them all dearly too, but I think there's something probably just like that shared experience of suffering together.
I think for athletics too, when people stop playing, like, I think professional sports to an extent, like they get maybe less discipline or less focus, I would say. Like for both of us, like I think there's maybe some unfinished business to an extent. So I think like our vision got tighter and like our discipline got tighter and more focused. And I think that led to this. I mean, yeah.
Why do you think that is, that your vision became more focused?
Well, I know for me, I had a lot of injuries. I blew out my knee. I had Tommy John surgery. I tore my rotator cuff in my labrum, my shoulder. I had pretty much every injury a baseball player and a pitcher could have. So,
is that what you were, a pitcher? You were a pitcher?
Yeah. Yeah. I was a closing pitcher. So I look back at it, you know, when I got drafted, I was expecting to play for a lot of years. And so that to be like my life, my identity, and all the things that are associated with that. And
how fast did you pitch? What was your, how fast?
Oh, I could get up into the high 90s. Wow. Throw pretty hard.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it was, I don't know about today, but I was back in the day I could. And I think like I was associated with like that being who I was, what my identity was going to be. And it got to an extent, I would say, taken away from me from no fault of my own. You know, I worked as hard as anybody, and you know, the bounces just didn't happen the way they were supposed to. So I think like on the other side of that, I just felt like, you know, maybe I need to go get, I don't know, do my own thing, or I need to like somehow make up for that.
Make up for
two things that I could control. Yeah. I don't know what it was. I don't know if make up for it's the right way, work the right word, but do something to kind of like redeem that experience or what I feel got taken away from me.
Could also be, especially because of the sustainability of this effort that you experienced young through college, yeah, beyond until now, is that it's maybe it wasn't so much of a make up for it as much as a redirect it, because always there. So it was like, what do I do with this drive, this purpose, this need to be successful and excel, and where can I put that energy now?
Yeah. And I went through like a period of time. So after baseball, I worked for a big tech company for about 5 or 6 years. And I went through a period of time where like life was fulfilling and exciting, right? But it wasn't like, didn't like have that like all on the line feeling like you have as a closing pitcher and you do as an entrepreneur. So I was happy. I was very fulfilled, but I was like miscast in a way.
What about you, Matt? Did you, I mean, what ended, what why did you stop hockey? And what were the feelings around that? Because anytime we lose something, I mean, this is speaking to everyone, where there's like big transitions and things that you become very attached to and things that are, you know, you have this vision, whether it's a job or a place you live or relationships, like we get this imagination for what it's going to be. And then when it's not, there's a breakup, there's a dissolving, there's a big shift. So how did that go for you?
It was hard at first. So I had a really bad concussion my last year playing. I played in the minors for a few years and got whacked in the head pretty hard and realized I had probably more concussions than I was aware of or acknowledged at the time. and I think what you just said made a lot of sense, Danica, too. Just like I had a lot of work ethic and drive and ambition and passion. And then for me, it was always so easy. I could go shoot pucks. I could get on the ice. I could work out. And I could just do it all day long. It was very easy to fulfill that, all the passion, work ethic and all that stuff. It's easy for me to do that in a physical sense. And then I think the hardest part, one of the hard things that I just had to transition was like, how do I use my brain, essentially, like the way I was able to use my body? It was really easy, again, just to put in hours and hours of practice. What does that look like as an entrepreneur? It's a lot of just like sitting there and thinking, reading, listening to podcasts, networking, picking people's brains, learning from other entrepreneurs and businesses. It was hard to figure out how to use my brain muscle, I guess. And then the other thing was just, you know, I wanted to play in the NHL. I didn't quite get there. I had a successful collegiate career. A lot of it was understanding, like, why would I actually want to play in the NHL? And kind of unpacking that a little bit and realizing I realize I can achieve all of those things and more now as an entrepreneur. And it wasn't so much about the actual game of hockey. It lit me up. I was passionate about it. I could create a certain lifestyle from it. I loved what I did. I loved the process of it. Once I realized entrepreneurship could give me that, then I sort of was able to move on from hockey and, you know, find other things that I could sink my time into.
That being what? What did you get from that being hockey that you realized you could get from being an entrepreneur doing something else?
Just the lifestyle that I wanted to create. One of the things is just financial freedom. You can do that in hockey, obviously do as an entrepreneur. Hockey gave me a sense of fulfillment and just passion. I love the process of being a hockey player. I equally, or if not more now, love the process of an entrepreneur, and like what it is to start a company and hopefully have a successful ending to it and everything in between that. There's a lot of parallels the way I correlate it that I could just, it just really is like the process and the journey of trying to achieve and accomplish something. It's kind of just like a never ending, like constantly trying to get better. And I didn't find this when I first stopped playing. I worked at a financial firm, and I didn't find that like sort of in the corporate role. I didn't find sort of that fulfillment, that passion where, you know, I could feel the same emotions and gratification from that.
Yeah, you must feel the same thing to an extent.
I don't know what you're talking about. No. I mean, I got to do my sport. I got to do my sport for 27 years. So, yeah. You know, I think that, and it was my decision to be done. And so I do think that there's a difference. It doesn't mean that there's not still a reorientation of what it is that your purpose is. And what keeps you fulfilled. I definitely realized that what I loved about racing was getting outside of my comfort zone and pushing that all the time. I thought I hated it. I actually thought that I was kind of scared, and I'm such a methodical driver that I wasn't the kind of driver who would just get in and go flat through one and two first lap. And, you know, I'm just making up words and make sense to anyone that was a race car driver, but I didn't have that overachieving, you know, could end in tragedy kind of mentality. I was very methodical. So I thought that the danger and the challenge, it wasn't the danger, it was the challenge. It was like the discomfort. I thought the discomfort was something I didn't like, that I just had to kind of butt up against. But when I finished racing, I realized that it's the discomfort that I really seek. And so now I found myself doing things like, you know, learning how to do everything from like skiing and snowboarding to wake surfing to, you know, bungee jumping and jumping out of helicopters and skydiving. And even just doing interviews or, you know, whatever else. I've realized that I'd like to do things that get me uncomfortable. So was there something that you similarly realized about what you were doing before versus what you're doing, what you led into, that you realized that you loved about it so much? Like for me, it was that discomfort. I liked pushing it. Were you able to isolate some aspect of it that you really loved?
I think it was, you know, we just talked about this at our BM retreat. Lloyd asked, this is a deep question, but he asked, we did a like a couple hour long thing with the whole team, and the last prompt and the question was, what is the purpose of life? What's your purpose of
great
life?
Great question. I'd love for you guys to answer that.
I thought about it for like 15 minutes, and I kind of settled on, I think it changes over the course of your life as you become a different person.
Right. And I think there's a difference between the purpose of life and your purpose of life.
Exactly. Hearing you talk about after racing in you and also myself, I think it's not the discomfort that I would necessarily was seeking, but I think it's like the way that I answered that question was maximize my potential. Mm. And I think, you know, it's not, you know, you obviously, you clearly did that in racing, but there are other areas in your life that you'd want to maximize, whether it was skydiving or interviewing or whatever it is. I feel like, for me with baseball, maybe that was the unfinished business. That's why I started doing Ironmans, which is like, I have no business doing Ironmans, a 2.5 mile swim, 112 mile bike, and then a marathon. But I didn't know why I wanted to do that. But when I connect the dots, looking backwards, I think it's because I wanted to maximize my potential. Mm-hmm. When I look at this journey and how hard this has been, you really would have to be insane to want to do this willingly. This is not very fun what we're doing, to be honest. But what I think I hope on the other side of it is, and what I know I'm doing on a daily basis, is like maximizing my potential everywhere I can. So I think that's what the purpose is for me now, at least.
Mm. Maybe the last question, maybe at the end, we'll ask what, you know, your purpose of life is, but go ahead. Okay. Matt, something that you recognized.
Yeah. Yeah. It was always, just to inspire the journeys of others. It's something that's always just gotten me excited and motivated me. I think, partly, I've just always had a little bit of an underdog story through sports and even, you know, becoming an entrepreneur and things that we're doing at Beam and, you know, dealing with challenging times, you know, building Beam now, like wanting to leverage that. So that not just if you want to be an athlete or an entrepreneur, but like you said, Danica, like everyone can relate to overcoming adversity and challenges and things like that. And it's always helped me just to keep focus on charging ahead, just if my story, my journey of how I'm approaching life or business, personal, etc., could be helpful to someone else. I think that to me, that's always popped out as something that's really important. And that was definitely in my mind as a hockey player was, you know, I want my career to be inspiring to a young hockey player's career. Now, just more broadly speaking, just like the overall journey.